Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of HOPStart. Today's episode is action-packed. So without much further ado, Shivro, take it away with my scoop.
Hi, I'm Suyash, and I'm the founder and CEO of MyScoot.
Hey Suyash, welcome to HOPStart.
Thank you so much for having
Thanks
me.
Thanks for taking out some time from your busy schedule.
Thank you so much.
Let me quickly jump to my first question.
Sure.
What's MyScoot all about?
So MyScoot is a platform for you to meet interesting, like-minded people, share your passions, and make money while doing it. Right?
Okay.
The product works just like an Airbnb, where you can either host a get-together or a gathering at your home, right? And as a guest, you can choose from a various variety of events happening around you. Let's say you're interested in baking cupcakes.
Yeah.
You can go and bake it along with someone who's opened up their home baking cupcakes.
Right.
You can do salsa get-togethers. You can do board game brunches. You can do backyard barbecues, right? So the concept is for you to meet people offline in the real world, right? Instead of spending all your time in front of a screen.
Oh, interesting. And you just mentioned that you can even make money out of it?
Yes.
How do you, how does someone get to that?
Absolutely. So as a host, since you're opening up your home and your space to meet new people, right, you can actually charge people for your experience, right? Let's say you're throwing a salsa get together at your place.
Yeah.
Our ticket sizes vary anywhere between 500 to 1200 rupees.
Okay.
And hosts on average on our platform get to make about 3000 to 5000 rupees per gathering that they host.
Right.
So, and these are all from the tickets that, you know, people buy from their platform.
Okay. Interesting. You know, we live in a country which has a population more than a billion.
Right.
And there might be a situation where you want to organize an event and kind of call in people, but you want to first verify them before that.
Right, right.
Because it's like a close event, right, at
absolutely,
the end of the day.
Absolutely.
How does someone take care of this situation?
Sure. So that's a very valid point, and that is one of the most important factors for us to make sure that every person in our community and on our platform is verified and screened by us. We have a five-step screening process.
Okay.
And only after that do you even get access to the platform.
Okay.
Right? And on top of that, after this, whenever you want to attend any of these get-togethers, parties, gatherings, it's up to the host to sort of accept or reject your request.
Okay.
So for example, if you're hosting something, you will see on your screen that there are 10 people who've sort of sent you their interests.
Right.
You can choose who you want to accept and who you don't want to accept.
Okay. So Interesting. I mean, when you're saying this, this sounds a little similar to kind of a Facebook event.
Right.
How do you differentiate yourself from that platform?
Absolutely. So so there are two major differences from a Facebook event, right? Let's say if you're putting up your gathering on the Facebook's platform, what happens is, first of all, the people who send you interests will not be verified. Anyone can access your event.
It's publicly open, right?
And if you have a closed group, for instance, then for other people to even look at your event, you have to promote it.
Right.
And for that, you have to pay Facebook to promote your event amongst a lot of people, right? And the third thing is also payments, right? So we take care of the payments seamlessly, right? So for these, to combat these three things, we verify everyone, right? You don't have to pay our platform, you get paid to host events. And number three is we take care of everything for you as a host, even logistics, even organizing and structuring the get-together. We do even that for you.
That's very interesting. You're actually cutting out the mediators in between and kind of directly kind of dealing with the people who want to host something.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's actually quite an interesting model. And how do you like generate revenue through this? Because it's a career-oriented show. A lot of people look into it from a perspective to start their career from.
Yes.
So if you don't mind, if you can share, like, how do you kind of generate revenue through this?
Sure, yeah. I mean, to start off with, we take a very small percentage of each transaction that happens on our platform. It's more of a convenience fee, so to speak. And that is what we've started with. But we see a lot of additional revenue generation options in the future with collaboration with brands, helping other early stage startups promote their brands on our platform, right? Because we've seen a lot of early stage startups, we've helped them sort of promote their brands amongst our audience, right? Even physical products, like let's say you started a cupcake business, right? We help you host a cupcake get together. We sort of promote that amongst our audience. Mm-hmm. People attend your cupcake get together. Right. Not only you get paid for hosting that event, mm-hmm. but you also get leads for your business.
Sure.
And the same thing can be applied for any kind of a business. Let's say you want to do salsa. Mm-hmm. We promote it amongst our salsa specific audiences. Mm-hmm. If you want to play board games,
yeah.
right? So we essentially also promote a lot of micro entrepreneurs on our platform.
Awesome. And so the next question is, I'm sure your team is expanding. You're pulling in more people.
Absolutely.
What kind of characteristics you look into people who want to kind of join your team?
Sure. I think the first and the foremost thing that I look for is attitude.
Okay.
Because none of this is rocket science. Anyone can do it.
Mm.
It's just about having the right attitude
mm.
to solve a problem, which is at the end of the day, it is all about solving a problem, right?
Yeah.
You break it down into different pieces and you solve it.
Exactly. I mean, in HOPStart, I've been meeting a lot of people and everyone's been saying the same thing, you know?
Yeah.
It's like the best way to come out with a nice business model is actually look for the right solution.
Absolutely.
For a problem.
Absolutely.
And that works quite well.
Right.
And before I wrap up, it was a very interesting chat, by the way. I wish I could have like continued, but
Absolutely.
We have our time constraints.
Sure.
Before wrapping up, before the interview, actually, you were mentioning about digital loneliness.
Right, right.
Let's quickly like brush on this a little
for
bit.
For sure. So, yeah. I mean, when I was starting up,
mm.
and since this was a personal problem that I faced,
yeah.
I was also researching on people who are like me, mm-hmm. right? And I chanced upon this article by the World Economic Forum,
mm-hmm.
which mentioned that almost 40% of the people under the age of 25 are lonely and have reported that they are lonely, right?
Okay.
And the other piece that I chanced upon was that 23% of Indian students
mm-hmm.
actually spend more than 8 hours on social media every day.
Oops.
And I personally believe that there is a strong correlation between the two.
After this, I'm also going to keep a tab on how much time I'm spending on social media. But yeah, this is quite a valid point and everyone should look into it. Is
Absolutely.
There any kind of an initiative you've taken for this?
No, so for this, I think the biggest thing that we're trying to do is getting people to actually talk to other people face to face in real life.
Yeah.
You know, we try to have offline events.
A real-time conversation rather than...
Yes, we actually are planning to do
mm-hmm.
something like a, you know, you have a lot of chairs on the
mm-hmm.
road.
Mm-hmm.
You just come and sit, someone sits in front of you, and then you just have a conversation with that person. And you can actually see the relief and the happiness on their faces when they are talking to someone.
Wow.
Instead of just scrolling through tons of stuff on social
media. And
getting
confused further.
Exactly. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Awesome. So yes, that was quite an insight. Well, thank you so much for being a part of HOPStart. It was great chatting with you.
It was amazing. Thank you so much.
These are certain very interesting insights we get talking to so many people in HOPStart.
Got it.
You were one of them. Thank you so much for
thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure.
Thanks. 2, 1.
Since we're done with my scoot, we're not done with the episode, because now we're going to talk to some people in the antivirus business. Some cybersecurity for y'all.
Hi, I'm Sanjit Chatterjee and I'm the country manager of the Reef Group in India.
Hi sir, thank you for coming on HOPStart. So let's just start with what is Reef, if you can give us a brief explanation.
So the Reef, our company name is Reef Systems. We work in, we are a software company and we work in the domain of telecom, which is voice over IP technology. We work in web engagements, which is live chat. And cybersecurity and IT security products. Our brand name for cybersecurity for the consumer is Reef Antivirus,
okay.
where it's a consumer antivirus for Windows, Mac, and Linux machines. And we have a Reef Endpoint Security and two-factor authentication and some other security solutions for enterprises.
Okay, because I mean, cybersecurity is something that everyone is realizing the importance of slowly, right? So how have you seen the cybersecurity market change, at least in India?
So the awareness is increasing, the risk levels are increasing even faster in India and globally.
Hmm.
Earlier, the risks were limited to large enterprises, financial organizations, or even mid-size, but now the risks have come down to SMEs and individuals as well. So the risk proportions are really large, And yes, the awareness and other preparedness is to keep pace with those.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with you, sir, because I guess, well, we live in a world where everything now is online, right? Mm. So even me paying for something as small as my food through encryption is now like, is online, and encryption is what prevents it from being stolen, right? So a couple of years ago, there was this massive debate around in the US about an iPhone that the FBI couldn't get into because it was a terrorist iPhone and they couldn't get into it, and there was about creating a master key and encryption. Where do you think that cybersecurity should limit itself? Do you think that a government master key should be allowed so that, you know, people can read consumer like metadata, or is it something that you think that cybersecurity shouldn't get into?
So, you know, it's a balance between privacy and, you know, what, you know, the law enforcement agencies can have access to, what you're saying. So there are other ways of making trails. What you are referring to is the issue of individual privacy.
Yeah.
And that itself is a huge concern because, as you rightly said, everything is digitized. All our photographs are now digitized. Yeah. We don't print them anymore. Yeah. All our documents, our mark sheets, or whatever documents you have are digitized. You store them digitally.
Soft copies of passports, Aadhaar cards.
Everything. Yeah. So all your data, bank statements, everything. And if you were to lose those, or if anybody has access to those, you know, it's a huge detriment to you as an individual. However, there are enough bad characters in the system where the law enforcement agencies need access. So yes, that's a trade-off between things. Ideally, yes, law enforcement should have, if there's a genuine case, but the you know, brief of iPhone is about privacy, and that's why a lot of people use things like WhatsApp, which are encrypted, rather than, you know, which can be, you know, tapped upon, etc., which are regular phone lines. So this is a delicate balance, and there is no clear yes or no in this.
I
think the both sides should be heard, and there should be a balance struck in this.
Yeah, because, sir, like, the more we move forward, there's in fact this famous quote, I've forgotten by who, that metadata is somehow now the most important resource for advertisers because it's so much easier for them to understand. So where do you see, do you think that cybersecurity should now start, you know, preventing things like theft of metadata, like as we've seen in countless cases across the world with Cambridge Analytica and stuff like that? Do you think that itself is its own danger, or again, that's just a product of an industry that's growing?
So that part is primarily more for understanding an individual's behavior and targeting advertising or content, you know, a more personalization, which leads to higher conversion. And that's what the entire online business is all about, that there's a nameless individual at the end of it who, you know, displays certain, you know, behavioral characteristics, and I throw, you know, products or advertising in that. So that, I would believe, is in majority cases harmless, or it doesn't really influence, you know, harm the individual interests. But yes, there are, you know, hackers, or there are people who are creating malwares, and their intention is to distribute that and ensure that they collect data. For example, I could send you a link which poses as your bank's link and everything, the look and feel, and you could end up entering your username and password. Yeah. And that's what I capture and end up doing a transaction from you.
True.
So that's what a cybersecurity is probably more focused at preventing today. So for individuals, then for organizations, theft of data.
Yeah.
You can, that's where the major probably concentration is. But well, what you talked about may not, it's kind of a maybe low priority, or maybe in certain markets is high priority.
Yeah.
But the major action today is to kind of prevent corporates and, you know, the data thefts and the system crashes, or the entire disruption of systems that malware is create.
Yeah, so I guess we've now painted a picture of a scary new industry. So where does Reeve come in? What are the unique solutions that Reeve provides for a cybersecurity industry that's now growing and has to find more solutions to problems?
So Reeve, as I said, we have a consumer antivirus, which is Reeve Antivirus, the brand which is used by consumers for their own personal and small businesses that they run. And then we have a solution which is called Endpoint Security, which is for enterprises, small to large. Our products are designed with two objectives. One is the simplicity of use, because we find a lot of small and medium enterprises cannot afford high-end resources to manage their systems.
Yeah.
So you need to create products which are layman proof, as we say. So that's one. The second is our products, obviously we look at the external part where somebody from the external world is coming and trying to steal information or disrupt your systems. But also we find increasingly in our companies, there is an internal threat, which are your rogue employees or people who have, you know, who are moving out. They carry out, you know, data of the enterprise, and which could be used in their own things or other. So this is what we also look at, you know, through our data loss prevention mechanisms to prevent. While we do this, there is also a productivity angle where a lot of enterprises come and tell us that our employees are spending too much time on non-productive things, like, you know, they're watching YouTube or, you know, Facebook or Twitter, or they're doing e-commerce, and they would want to have caps or, you know, a surveillance on these activities so that people don't use productive, you know, office time for doing this. They don't want to block it.
Yeah.
There are certain organizations who block things. Most organizations, they don't want to do that blocking route, but they would want to identify people who are over abusing the system. So that's one of our key areas that we work in. And obviously on the detection, because the primary thing is to detect malwares.
Yeah.
We have very high rate of detection in terms of identifying day zero. We're using artificial intelligence and machine learning to ensure that we are up one step ahead against the malware creators.
Fair enough. So just to conclude, I'd like to ask you then, what, you know, there are many young people who watch this show. So if there is an 11th, 12th student who wants to do engineering and he or she wants to get into cybersecurity, what should they do?
So cybersecurity is an area where there's a very large skill shortage in India and globally. Why? Because suddenly the levels of threats have increased. And companies are scrambling up solutions, but you need people to manage those. So we find a lot of companies that we go to, they bought expensive tools or tools, but they don't have adequate people to manage them. Mm. So hence, there is no action happening. Then obviously, the basic skills of network administrators or IT administrators have to focus on security, which it hasn't. So they are still working in the past in terms of, you know, keeping only networks and connectivity, but they're not looking at the software side and the security loopholes.
Mm.
So there is a very large demand of trained people, good people, people who understand operating systems, people who understand how malwares work, the Windows, which is obviously the largest ecosystem in the world, and obviously, then solutions which make the product easier and more adaptable to. So for people who are either looking at a career option or are already pursuing some branches of computer engineering, there is absolutely going to be very, very high demand of programmers in the system, of malware analysts, you know, people who can understand, people who understand, you know, the Windows environments, you know. And these people currently, you know, there are certain skill sets which are really at a premium. And India has really a shortage of such people. So there is absolute scope for people to get into this.
Okay. Thing. All right. Thank you so much. So this has been a very interesting chat. And I will definitely be more careful now when I'm online. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for having me in the show.